Welcome back to Ox Tools, I'm Tom. So this is another Meatloaf episode. Got a couple things going on. We got some viewer mail, a little bit of mail from viewers, and then a few packages from fellow YouTubers. So some of the guys that have related channels that are in the network, so to speak, sent me some stuff, and we trade back and forth a little bit, so we'll crack some of those open and take a look at that. We have a tool to show, kind of a unique tool, and this is a tool that I picked up for Stan, Shaden HKW down in Southern California. He makes the little square, so he and I have been talking about ways that he could check the squareness on them faster. He's making quite a few of them now, I guess. So anyway, I found this tool locally, and he was interested, so I picked it up. And we're going to show that tool, and we'll maybe do a little demo with that. What else? I just wanted to say thank you, all the guys that that chimed in about the indicator glare problem. And I think we got a practical solution coming up here. It does work to put some neutral density filter on top of the dial. So that's what I'm doing short term, but I've ordered some other material, which is made by 3M, and it's to cut glare on like navigation screens and monitor screens and things like that. It's kind of like a Fresnel lens. It has a lot of different grooves in it that that direct light, so it cuts glare. Anyway, so we're going to try some of that. I ordered a chunk of that, and that should be here in a few days, and we'll try that. Then the other thing is I thought I'd tell a story. Okay, you guys, you know, you read my whiteboard here. Well, there's been a few things on here for a while, so we're going to knock some stuff off. So I'm going to tell you guys the Space Center camera story. So many years ago, I was in Huntsville, Alabama, and I was we were back there for a metalworking event. And anyway, we went to the U.S. Rocket Center there. It's basically a museum. It's part of the Smithsonian, I think. And anyway, they have all kinds of space memorabilia, rocket engines. They've got a whole Saturn V laying down on its side in the yard. It's just fascinating. So if you're ever in Alabama or near Huntsville, I totally recommend go check this thing out. It's really cool. Now, the funny part is there's a display, okay? And the display is a moonscape, and on the moonscape is the lunar dune buggy, you know, the lunar rover that the astronauts, not the one that they drove around, they left that one at the moon, but this was a prototype. Anyway, it's in there, and so it's got this big boom, right? And mounted on the top of this boom is a camera, much like the one I'm looking at right now. And so a friend and I were walking through, and we kind of went into that area, not in the normal order. We kind of went in backwards, and so we come up to this display, right? And so here's this rover, right? I'm like, oh wow, cool! Look, it's got the mesh tires and all this, and you know, I'm gesturing with my hands like this. Well, the little camera on the boom goes bloop, and starts looking at me, right? And I was like, wow, look at that. That's cool, right? The camera is active, right? And so I went like this, and you know, I just moved my hand off to the side, and the camera went bloop, and it followed my hand. And I said, oh my God, this thing is cool. It's tracking my movements, right? So I put my hand out the other way. Bloop, you know, camera goes over there. And anyway, so I'm like, totally, this is total nerd stuff, okay? Anyway, I'm fascinated. This thing's tracking me. So I move over a little bit, and it follows me, and I move over a little bit this way, and it follows me. And I do one of these, right? I duck down, and then pop up over here, and the camera comes over, right? And anyway, this is cool. So I'm playing around with this camera, right? Anyway, I make a movement, and the camera goes, and it goes the other way. And I'm like, what the hell's going on, right? So I start doing all kinds of weird stuff, right? And here's the funny part. I hear somebody laughing on the other side. Well, it turns out that this stupid thing is remote control. So if you go in the exhibit the right way, there's a remote control stick that you could drive the camera around. Well, a couple of guys are over there driving the camera around, and they're watching this bozo duck and move around and wave his arms, right? Anyway, they were rolling on the floor laughing, and once I realized that, I was pretty embarrassed, but it was funny. And so then I went around the other side, and I got to do the remote control and try it. And yeah, they had little crosshairs, and you could steer it around, you know, and zoom it a little bit. Anyway, it was a crack up. I'm sure it was more funny for the guys that were doing the remote control. Anyway, that's the Space Center story. So we're going to take that off of here. Okay. And then next time, what do we got? Are we working outside? Maybe we'll do that one next time. That's actually a pretty funny story told to me by the guy I served my sheet metal apprenticeship with. So he was from New Zealand, and it's a pretty funny story. So let's get an apron on. Let's look at some viewer mail and look at this tool, this square checking tool, and let's have some fun. Okay, so we got some viewer mail and some fellow YouTuber mail. So let's do the viewer mail first. What we got here is this comes from Bill De La Vega down in Southern California, and you know, he's been watching the exposure problems that we've been working through, and so he sent me this is a 18% gray, I believe it's 18% gray card to set for whatever ambient light you have. You set your exposure on that and kind of lock it down, and then shoot. Although this sheet metal background's working pretty good. Anyway, Bill, thank you very much for that. And what I really want is one of those ones with the stripes on it that have the graduation. So, I still appreciate this. This is great. And but I want to get one of those. I'm just saying, I want to get one of those ones with the stripes that have the graduations of the grays. So when you see all those in the shot, when you can see all the different graduations, you know, you're properly exposed for that light condition. Anyway, Bill, thank you very much. That's great. We'll put that to use. We'll try it out and see if we can improve the exposure settings. Okay? Okay, so next one, we got fellow YouTubers, and most of you guys follow these guys also. Master Chuck, Outside Screwball. You know, he must have knocked over an office depot or a Staples, because he's flush with big fat Sharpies, or else he's taken up tagging in his spare time. So anyway, he sent me some of these, and they're real nice. You can use these for basically dike them and apply it to a surface really quickly, and it has the same kind of properties as Dicom. Okay. Anyway, thanks, Chuck. Appreciate that. And don't go writing on buildings with these. Okay, buddy. Okay. You get that? Okay. So the next one here is, we got some stuff from Stan down in Southern California, and his channel is Shaden HKW, and he sent me a little handful of stuff here, which is really cool. So we got some chisels here, and these are real nice chisels, and a big carbaloy bit here. This is a big fat guy here. This is an Adam style here, a big 3/4 inch. But this is a real useful geometry here, you know, this 80, well, I guess it's 80 degrees or something. It's not 90, it's a little more than 90, so more acute than 90, but it's not a 60 either. So, what is it? Yeah, carbaloy. Anyway, so we may make use of that. It looks like it's, no, it hasn't been touched up, so maybe not. I don't know. Anyway, that's nice. Then we got some plum chisels here, and it looks like he took a little bit of rust off some of these. But basically, most of these look kind of unused here. This looks like the factory grind here of the of the hammering end here, and there's no mushrooming that I can really feel on that one in particular. And this is a Plum Los Angeles, is a half-inch chisel, cold chisel, and like I said, I think these are factory grinds on that. That looks pretty good. Now this one, it's got a little flaring there. This one's been whacked a couple of times, but you can't even tell. You know, and I have a bunch of chisels, but so these will be a little upgrade to the ones I have, and the other ones will go in a special box that we're saving up some stuff. Oh, look at that. It's a nice graduation there. And then there's a big fatty here, 5/8. This also a Plum, Los Angeles. And this has seen very little use. It's got like one hit on it or something like that. So is what it looks like. So those are kind of nice. Let's see, let's set these up here. Kind of graduate them by size. And then we got an itty bitty one here. And this is a 1/4 inch. Now this one looks like Stan went over this one a little bit here. Maybe it was real rusty or something, I don't know. But still looks good. It's got the kind of medium old logo there. It's marked Los Angeles. So that kind of dates it, I think. I don't remember what the what era that is when they were marking them Plum Los Angeles. So somebody else will know that. Okay, so there's a nice selection of chisels. Now this one's kind of interesting here too. It's also the same thing. It's a Plum Los Angeles, but this one's set up so that you can kind of get down onto a flat surface. These or reach into something, right? These are a little different because they got a double bevel on them. This has a single bevel, so you can get down flush. So you can chip something off, and then you can chip it off flush. And, you know, a lot of people, you know, there's a lot of stuff that you can do with chisels, and we haven't really talked about any of that. And, you know, guys used to cut keyways with these. They used to gouge slots with them. There's all kinds of stuff you could do with chisels. And, you know, at some level it's satisfying, you know, tapping away and chewing some of that stuff out. Anyway, Stan, thank you very much. That's a real nice gift. And I think he got a lot of tools, and these were like new old stock or something like that, which is a really nice find there. Good job, Stan.
Thanks.
So we got those. Let me set those aside. And then Stan sent another thing here. So this is a snap-on or a blue point, and it's just a chuck that looks like it fits on the end of a 3/8 drive here. 3/8 square. Maybe it's a tap driver. Maybe, I don't know. Well, it doesn't have a square socket down in the bottom. I don't know exactly what that's for. Wear safety goggles. So it's not that old. So it looks like it snaps on a 3/8 ratchet, and you can grab a drill or a tap or something there in these quick change jaws. So that's pretty cool. And then the last thing that's really neat, and he said, hey, get a tetanus shot before you play with this. So what we got here is it's a spring parting holder. Okay. Now this has been laying in some water or whatnot. We'll do a little cleaning on it, but it's got that split in it. And this one holds a parting blade, and it's even got an Armstrong parting blade as part of the kit here. So let's stick. Oop, I had it in there. Oh, there it goes. Okay. So that locks in there, and it's got the wrench and everything. This is pretty cool. Okay. That's not where you want it. You want it something like that. Okay. So the idea is when, you know, it puts this pivot point of the tool tip up here, so it backs it away from the work when it bites in, you know, if it bites in the work, right, instead of the whole tool post rocking in and it digging in more, it pivots here, and that's what that split's about. And they've relieved it so that the blade doesn't interfere with that also. So I'm going to drag the other one out real quick. This is my interpretation of that that fits in an Aloris, okay? And so maybe it looks like I might be able to fit this in my toolbox. So maybe we'll give this a little test drive over on the lathe and try it out. So that's pretty cool. Anyway, Stan, that's pretty neat. Thank you very much. And you don't see these very often, so we're going to do something special with this, I think. So I already kind of told Stan a little bit, but I'll let you guys in on it in a little bit. Okay, anyway, moving on. Okay, so the last one comes to us. This is from Paul Compton, and he's in the UK. And anyway, he sent me a little he sent me a little package here with some miscellaneous stuff in it. And so these are some timing belts. Apparently, Paul's got an abundance of these. These are off these little Marini motorcycles that he works on. And so he says he generates a large quantity of these belts. So anyway, they just look like standard timing belts here, 124L. So that's the length and the actual size. So I'm not going to unfold them. Anyway, they're just timing belts, and maybe we can put them to use for something. But anyway, thank you very much for that. Then he sent me a Paul Compton TIG finger here. And so this is his fiberglass tubing here that is used to insulate wires and things in high temperature environments. Jody over at Welding Tips and Tricks sells a real nice one similar to this. It's a little bit smaller and it fits over your finger, so when you're TIG welding, you can lay your hand on a hot surface and still do the work. Anyway, that's the general idea there. And so Paul sent me one. It looks like he made it out of the same material. Anyway, it's pretty cool. And I have a couple of other ones, and I'll put it with those. And I've used these. They work really good. You got a hot surface, and you really need to rest your hand on it. You know, I mean, just like that, even, you can just go. And it insulates your hand from a surface that can be actually quite hot. So anyway, thank you very much for that, Paul. That's great. And then the last thing is more of a, I think it's a little bit of a joke gift here. So some of our viewers in the UK recognize this. This is Marmite, and this is this kind of very different, I don't know, condiment, I guess we'd call it. It's a yeast extract, and it's got a very strong flavor, very distinct flavor. I've had it before. It's actually kind of interesting. You got to go easy with it. And you know, anything that says store in a cool, dark place, that's kind of interesting. And I like a good squeeze between some bread and cheese. So anyway, that's how you use it. And you make sandwiches out of it, kind of like a spread. And the Australians use a similar thing called Vegemite, which is also a very distinctive flavor, a unique flavor. And and if you've never had it before, it's nothing. It's like nothing you've ever tried. So if you haven't tried it, try it. This is, you know, part of our education in other cultures and other flavors, is to try these things. And you don't have to like it, you know, but just try it. You know, maybe you will like it. So anyway, Paul, thanks for that. And I'm going to get some. I don't have any bread right now, or I'd make a little cheese sandwich and put some on that and eat it on camera. But I think that's. That'll last me a little while there. That's 200 grams, and so that's a fair amount. So, and I will store it in a cool, dark place. So, thanks very much. All right. So, you know, Stan sent us this nice little collection of chisels here. So, I was looking. I wanted to stow these and put them away, and then I realized that I needed to kind of thin the herd a little bit. So, I thought it might be interesting. I just pulled the, ouch, I, stupid little latch thing. I pulled the drawer out of my my Kennedy toolbox there that has my punches and chisel drawer, the smaller ones, I should say. And I thought we'd just kind of go through it kind of quickly here. So that's a Sterrett center punch there. Sterrett automatic center punch. That's kind of a beat up pin punch, but you know, you need a couple of really chowdered ones that you're not afraid to abuse to get a job done. So, you know, that was a flea market find there, so I just cleaned it up. That's a rivet set for setting, you know, looks like about 3/16 rivets there. That's what that one's about. Okay, tapered drift, another tapered drift. So this is a repurposed wood chisel, Craftsman, little one here, you know, scraper slash chisel. Homemade brass punch, brass doinker that looks like it's been used a little bit. Another one, okay. And let's just do that stuff first. Let me just root through here. Okay, another little homemade jobber there that's been whacked on. I made that a long time ago. That was probably made on my first little lathe that I had, an old Prentice lathe, so I might have made that on there. And just some brass keystock that looks like it's seen some love from a hammer. Okay, another homemade brass punch. Okay. This is aluminum bronze here, so and that one's seen a hammer a few times. This stuff's really tough, so you can wank on that pretty good, and it doesn't mushroom on you. Okay, and then here's a little bit different kind of a punch. You can reach down into a slot and tap on something, or tap on something flat that has an edge that you want to spread that force out on. Like one more homemade, yeah. I think I was working on making a set or something, you know. I don't know what I was doing there, so they're kind of the same. That's a homemade stuff. And then one more. This is silicon bronze here. That was a hinge pivot pin at leftover piece from at a place I worked at. Okay, that's about it for the. I don't quite know why that's in there, but it's in there. All right, so let me clear the decks and we'll keep going here. Okay, so another tapered drift. Let's do the tapered drift. Oh, this one's kind of cool. We'll talk about that one in a second. Okay, tapered drift. There's a pretty good size one there. What else we got? This is a... This is a piece of, this is a drill blank, a 532 drill blank. Kind of a pin punch as well. Another kind of pin-like punch. And so, this is a prick punch that's been sharpened back a few times. And we'll talk about the real briefly the difference between a prick and a center punch. Okay, drive pin. And a lot of these are, you know, bought as singles or whatnot, you know, and modified to do some particular job. That one's seen better days. I think that was a prick punch too. That was a drive pin punch in its former life. Okay, there's one that looks pretty good. Yeah, punches, you know, they take, that's a Williams, kind of a straight drive pin punch there. Another tapered drift. Yeah, you could, you know, it's probably a good idea. I probably needed to thin this. There's some specialized thing that I made. Who knows what for? Can't even remember. It's a ball that's brazed to the end of a piece of stainless tubing, it looks like. I don't know. Custom. Okay, so here's a couple specials we'll talk about separately. Another drive pin. Okay, so I think that's about it for kind of round. Oh, now here's one. I think I talked about this on a meatloaf. This is one I found at the flea market, but it's octagonal. Is it octagonal? Hexagonal and tapered as a hex.
which is kind of interesting. So this would work good for removing socket head screws, and this could be for a square drive, some things, I don't know. And so somebody went ahead and made that. It doesn't have any marks on it that that I recall, but that's kind of a, you know, that was a flea market find. Okay, let me clear this out of the way. I'll clear this stuff out of the way, and then we'll keep going. Okay, let's talk about these. These are kind of specialized here. This is made by Mayhew, and I don't know if any of you guys have seen one like this, but this has a little bead on the end of it. And what this is for driving spring pins. So the idea is, you know, a spring pin is kind of hollow, so it has this little element here that helps center up on that spring pin to drive them out or in without mushrooming the ends up, and you get a good centering element there that keeps you from pounding that in. So that's a spring pin punch there, okay? Set that aside. Now this here, I'm gonna grab that. Let's do it on this here. What this is a spring-loaded center punch. So the idea is, and I used to carry this around a fair amount when I was doing a lot of center punching. You don't need a hammer, so you put that down, you hold this, and then give it a little doink, and it gives you a mark. So you just let go of it. So it's kind of like, you know, a simplified version of one of these here. You guys have probably seen these here. You know, these wear in a funny way. Actually, I got to clean some rust off of that. I used to use this a lot more when I had a lot of center punching to do, but it never left quite a big enough doink for me, so I kind of quit using it. So, but anyway, this is kind of a double ender here. And this end looks like I ground it off. Oh, I remember, because I used to keep this in my apron, and when I would lean over, that top would poke me. So I said, okay, I only need one end, so I just kind of ground that off. And anyway, that's how that works. It works pretty good, actually. Okay, moving on here. Chisels are next. Let's just look at your standard straight cold chisels here. This is a nice long one, so you can get a good grip on it and reach in somewhere. And you see I sharpen them a little bit differently here. I got a little radius on the front there so that you get a shearing action. So there's another one that's kind of done that way too. That's a big Proto, 7/8. That's an atom size one there, okay. What's that? That's a Williams, $2 Williams there, Proto. That one, I don't think that one's been used either, so. Craftsman. And what else we got in here? Oh, there's a Snap-on here. This one's been sharpened in a kind of a weird way here. Maybe you can see that. And once again, it can, you know, sit, you can get a flush cut with that, okay. And this one looks like I touched it up to make it sharper. I don't know what I was cutting, maybe something soft. But anyway, it allows you to cut kind of dead flush with the bottom there. So actually that looks non-stock as well. Okay. There's another. Okay, so there's one. I don't know what I was doing with that. Don't ask. Don't ask, don't tell, right? So I was probably embossing something and I just modified one of these. So, you know, if you have a bunch of smaller ones around, right, you know, you're not so worried about modifying them to do something special, right? And it's nice tool steel, it's hard, so they kind of last, and you can just touch them up and do whatever you want with them, so. Okay, and then, there's a teeny one there. I think I just got this one here. Nice tiny little one there. And looks like another Williams here, you know, about a quarter inch or something like that. I think that's about it for straight chisels. These are a couple more different sized Starrett center punches here. Let's see if I can find it. I don't see the bigger one. I like this square shank one because when you put them on the bench, they don't roll. And I just like the feel of the square of my hand, you know, the squared around there, and as opposed to something like this, you put it on the bench and it can roll, right? That's a prick punch. And the difference is the angle. The prick punch is a sharper angle for picking up scribe lines, and then this is a 90 degree point that gives you a really durable point that you can really smash with a hammer and get a good doink going. That's a smaller version. They have these in sets. Sterrett has those in sets. Okay, so the last group here are what we call cape chisels here, and there's a bunch of different flavors here, and we'll look at them, and that's kind of along that line. And you know, a lot of these are just different sizes here. Another one. Actually, I got quite a few of those because they're narrow. Okay, here's another one. And then the last group is these diamond points. So what these are for, and these come in conveniently in widths that are very close to keyways. And you can probably, let's look at a bigger one maybe, it might be easier. And maybe it's easier to see on that. But they're tapered, so they're widest in the front and then they taper behind. So like a lathe tool bit, you can lay out a keyway and you can actually use this to chip a keyway. Okay, you can, you know, you can, because you can come at it from an angle. So let's just pretend that this is the shaft, right? You can come at it like that and you can chip keyways out, you know. So you lay out lines and then you scribe and then you, you know, you can drill a little bit. So you can make a keyway, in other words, without a milling machine, okay, or a key seat. And in the, you know, long ago days, there was a lot of them that was cut that way, a lot of them that were cut that way. And this one's just an access one here. This allows you to kind of get in at some frightening angle here and chip away. And it's come in handy a couple of times because I've had to get at something. It's mainly just an access, you know, gives you better access. Okay. And then the last group here, and these are not a real durable geometry here, but these are diamond. You can cut a V-groove with these. There's one that's not too bad. That one's kind of rounded off for some reason. And so you can cut a kind of a V-groove with those, and there's a couple of flavors of those. Hopefully you can see that, okay? Anyway, I don't know what that one's. I don't know what was going on with that one. Looks like a flea market deal. Who knows? Anyway, the tour of the chisel. Hope you liked it. This next one, we're going to demo on the surface plate here. We'll give this a quick wipe down here. You know, things they move better when the plate's nice and clean, and there's just nothing on it. And you know, you always get a little bit of dust and a little bit of crud. So it's a good idea to go over them. And then once you get a really thin film of this on there, you know, it evaporates pretty quick. And this is a Sterrett surface plate cleaner here, special crud. So you can see it's drying up pretty fast, but it's just glassy now, you know. It's just glassy now. It's really nice. Okay. We'll bring this over. Okay, and all the stuff we're going to need. All right, so we got some goodies here. And you guys are all familiar with those, right? These are these angles that Uncle Stan makes. Okay, there's some different flavors. And here's, I'm privileged, I have some of the the very first production models here with a thinner web. So this is a, they don't make these anymore. These are, this is a rare version here. So they all have these thicker webs now. Okay. So what we have here, it's called the Square Master. Let's make sure you can see that in the, of course that's cut off in the, it's cut off in the thing here. Maybe I can pull this up a little bit. So, can you see that? Huh? Of course, you can't, still can't see it. Closer's not better, Tom. Farther. Farther? All right, you know what? Let me reframe that. Okay, that's a little better. Okay, so what this is this is basically a movable platform that carries an indicator with it. And it's got a little lever in the back, and I can bring this up and I can bring this down. Okay, and what's inside here is there's a granite column inside there. Very parallel and very accurate granite column. And it's mounted to a base that we can adjust its the squareness in relation to this reference plane, okay? And I'm just gonna tip this up for a sec. Let me rotate this a little bit so you can see the feet under here, okay? And there's the feet, and the feet are really cool. They're three point feet on a spherical mount, so I can push those around. So they're self-aligning, little kinematic type feet here. They find and set down properly. Okay, so they'll sit down. Now this thing is not automatically square. Okay, so that's why we have this out over here. So when this was originally sold, it had a big granite right angle here so that you could get this squared up. And so it has a fixed point here on this corner and then two adjustable feet diagonally. And so that you can tip the column fore and aft and then side to side, okay, to get it in alignment. So the idea behind this is that you set it against a reference square, probably not a cylindrical square, but a flat square, like kind of like this, okay. And this is the biggest one I have, you know. The one that came with this was probably this high, okay. And then what you do is you adjust this until when you traverse here, you get no reading. And that's perpendicular to this. Now you can be out the other way, and so you just basically sweep a surface that's perpendicular to that to get this so that it's tracking straight, okay? So there's kind of a two-step process, and once you get it aligned, it's fine. You set it on the surface plate, and then every time you want to use it, you'd probably double check that, okay? So it's got a couple of rest buttons here, and so you can put something against it here and then have a stop. And that's kind of what I was doing. I was playing around with this. And so for example, we want to check one of these. We come up and we can butt up against that, and then we can sweep that edge and we can get a quantitative measurement. Okay, so I can say, in that 3 inches there, it's out 2/10, or it's out 1/10, or you know, whatever it's out. So let me change the camera around. We'll get in a little closer and see if we can see some stuff with this. Okay, so we're set up here. We're kind of zeroed there, and I'm just gonna traverse this up. Anyway, the indicator's touching. Okay, so the movement is very, very smooth on this granite column, right? So that allows you to check something for squareness really easily. Now, so if we get down near the bottom, let's get this out of the way, okay? And so how you'd use it in practice here is we'd grab one of these little squarinos here, and we push it up against there, okay? And then, grab the handle here, Mr. Wizard. Then we, there you go. So looking pretty good there. And then we can just traverse down. Now you could build a little fixture to kind of snap these in so that it made it go in a little easier. Huh. What's going on there? Yeah. I don't know. It feels like it's rocking a little bit for some reason. I don't know why. So I'll have to look at that later. Is my arm killing the shot here? Maybe a little bit. All right, that's not too bad. All right. So, yeah, you know what? Stan, I think that this gun bluing continues to corrode here a little bit. That's what it looks like to me. Is this is residue from this gun bluing process that he uses? It might continue to kind of etch the surface here. Let's look at one of these other ones. Yeah, it's got some squank on it there. I don't know. All right, well, maybe I'll lap these and we'll try it again here. Let's just do another one here. Let's see if we can get it. You see, now that one feels better sitting down. Okay, oops. Then there's the danger right there, is that you can doink that, and I probably just knocked this out of alignment there, is you can run that down into the plate. So it might be a good idea to put something under it or something to, you know, stop the travel so you don't crash into the bottom like I just did there. Okay, so we got this old Armstrong spring tool holder set up in the Aloris. So kind of two tool holders in one here. And this is the spring one here with the pivot point above the cutting edge. So we're going to try parting off a piece of, this is 1 1/8 steel here and cold rolled. We're going to be running 285? It's 285. I could probably go a little faster than that. Well, we'll try it there first. I touched up the tool a little bit, and it's got a little positive rake on it there and a little chip curl. So let's lop a piece off and see how it behaves. You know, so I've squared it up with the world there. We'll just dice off a little chunk there and see how it works. Makes noise. Feels all right so far. Chips are coming off good. Oh, okay, didn't like that. All right, let's keep going here. The chip breaker's too radical. The chips aren't flowing out of there. I might have to touch that tool up a little bit, but let's see if we can get through one here. Now, I don't know if you noticed that, but it dove a little bit. It dove a little bit, and this did its little job there, and it didn't jam, which is kind of interesting. So let's try that again. I'm going to try to make it jam. Okay, here we go. All right, now it won't do it. we can make it do it. See that? So here's, this is kind of interesting here. So it did its little job there, but here's our problem. You see that? Can you see that? Maybe you can or can't. I'm gonna try to pop that loose. You see that? The chips were packing in that little slot. So that thing is, that sucker's hot too. That little slope is a little too much, so I think I'm just going to grind a little bit. I'll grind it more like that, and we'll give it another try. But you saw, actually, this is a good demo, I guess, right? You saw this thing do its little job there and flex out of the way. So let me redo that tool a little bit, and then we'll continue on. This is kind of fun. So okay, so we're back. I ground that kind of radical chip breaker out of the way there, and just kind of put a little bit of positive rake on that. Let's give it another go and see what happens here. All right. Chips are rolling out of there okay. Well, it's certainly behaving itself a lot better. Try a fresh one there. Let's see, maybe I think I'm gonna power feed it. Let's see what we got here. Some fun here. Yeah, I think that feed rate's a little too fast. Yeah, it's flexing the tool out. Oh, you know what? Maybe I need to square it up again. Let me, now, why would it move? Why would it move? Let me come out here. Yeah, I think that feed rate was a little too... oh yeah, something moved here. I don't know what. Okay, let's realign that. Oh, this is not... tool post wasn't very tight. So I'm just gonna align with my chuck jaw there. That looks pretty good. All right. Let's try that again. I think I'm gonna slow that feed rate down a little I think that was a little too fast.
Pull that out a little.
Ow. Darn it. Okay. All right, let's see. Okay, that's pretty slow feed right now. You know, this is off center a fair amount here. So maybe that's in the tool post wasn't super tight either. So, all right, let's power feed again. That looks better. Pretty cooperative. Okay, so that was actually a pretty good demo because we had a problem and then we kind of fixed it. It's also a good demonstration of how much tool geometry matters. Okay, the first go around we had a big hook chip breaker, which might be okay for aluminum or something else. But it didn't. Steel didn't like it. Okay. Now, what was cool about that, and this was completely unplanned, guys, that it actually jammed in there. It was a problem. Okay. And this little old Armstrong tool post that I don't think has ever been used. Okay. Did its little job. It's been sitting in a drawer for 50 years or more, and it still did its job. So pretty cool, though. Anyway, so we changed the top angle here a little bit, so it's just slightly like that. Okay, maybe I don't know, 1 degree, 2 degrees, maybe like this. Okay, and so that would be a positive tip, as opposed to flat. We're on center, 1018 steel at 285 RPM, and this is I don't know, what is this? It is 28 millimeter, you know, a little over an inch. And so anyway, you can see, you know, what the difference in tool geometry makes with that. So that's actually a pretty nice finish on there, not bad for parting. You know, you usually don't try to part to a final finish. So anyway, cool demo.